Good morning. As you've heard from Sahna, I teach at the University of St. Joseph in Macau, and I do the rest of the teaching in Sweden at Uppsala University. So many of the things that I talk about are based on my own experience in my own classrooms. And you need to know that I've been out of India for 20 years, and much of my assumptions are based on students in these countries. But what I'm going to talk about is what is going to happen eventually everywhere, and that is what I would like you all to keep in mind. Today's session is about the 21st century classroom and about using digital learning tools for students. So in many ways this is different from what you have been doing earlier, which is to put tools in the hands of the teachers. But this session is about allowing students to choose their own tools in order to demonstrate the learning that they have achieved. So first I would like you to consider this scenario. There are two teachers, let's just call them A and B, and for a given topic, teacher A asks the students to individually handwrite a report on paper and hand it in during class. Teacher B asks the students to create a digital presentation. We can assume that it would be in pairs or in a group, and to incorporate images, figures, links to web references and to videos in that presentation. Please consider for a minute this scenario. Teacher A, handwritten report, in class, individual work. Teacher B, digital presentation, in pairs or in groups, incorporating multimedia. According to you, which teacher's strategy is better? Teacher A, the one who has asked students for the handwritten version of the report, individual work, or teacher B, who has asked for pair or group work, and which is to be given in a multimedia format? Or option three, are both equally good? Participants, please vote on the question, and coordinators, please convey your response. We have responses coming in. So far we have teacher B, 17 responses, both 6 responses, and teacher A, 3 responses. So it seems overwhelmingly in favor of the technique or the strategy used by teacher B. So let us see and try to analyze the results in terms of what exactly do they mean. Teacher A, as you recall, asked for a paper report. From the teacher's perspective, it is easy to grade and return to the students by giving comments on the paper. From the student's perspective, it is possible to write the answers in the class and to submit it. But there are a few drawbacks that we need to keep in mind. For teacher A, there is no record of student work unless the teacher photocopies all the answers. And also, and I think this is more important, the teacher cannot use it as a future resource. For the student, the key drawback is that the student has to work individually, work alone, and the student does not have access to any multimedia resources to be able to project the kind of understanding or knowledge that the student has gained. So this is a summary of what it means if you follow the strategy by teacher A. So let's look at the other one. For teacher B, this teacher has given students a choice of using digital tools to demonstrate what they have learned. From the teacher's perspective, the students can demonstrate knowledge, which is the first component to be graded, as well as learn the skills to create, to communicate, and to collaborate with digital tools. From the student side, the student can learn from multimedia resources, not just the content, for example, given by the teacher, and students can also learn from each other during the pair work or the group work. The key drawbacks in this are that the teacher needs to assess the knowledge, the product that the students have submitted, and of course, the process of working together. On the other hand, the student has to learn how to use the digital tool and, of course, how to work with others. So as you can see, today's session is about addressing these drawbacks to students using digital tools. The learning objectives of this session are that at the end of it, you should be able to identify which digital tools are useful for students to use in and out of class. But I must point out at this stage that in my experience, allowing students the choice of tools is much more important, because then it allows us as teachers also to see the variety of tools that can be used for addressing a particular learning outcome. And the second objective of this session is that we learn how to apply a digital taxonomy to map the learning outcomes when our students use digital tools. So there are two main strands to this session. Let's reflect a typical, what I would say, a traditional classroom. The teaching methodology is very information transmission oriented. The teacher stands and delivers the content. The mode, as we can see, is instructional. The learning styles of the students are predominantly to read or write or to listen to the lectures. The student involvement is mostly confined to being given content and told how to address it. And the technology in use could be either learning about technology, that is literacy, or in most cases or in some cases, teaching with technology, that is augmented technology use. A typical traditional classroom scenario for you. It may or may not be what you have in your own class, but I would typify this as traditional in this session. So let's look at the 21st century classroom. Here the teaching methodologies are based on giving project-based assignments or problem-based learning to the students. The approach is very much constructionist with an N, not constructivist with a V, and in this sense it's more social-oriented learning. The learning styles that you can encourage your students to adopt are multiple, with application of multiple intelligences. The student involvement is in both constructing the content and also developing and evaluating the process of their own learning with the digital tools. And technology use here is transformative. That means they are learning through technology, not just from peer interaction or not just from the teacher. Now, this 21st century classroom scenario is already very much with us in many of the classrooms that we have nowadays. We have teachers moving towards project and problem-based learning. We have student involvement in choice of tools, technologies, and how they are presenting their work. So this defines, in a sense, a 21st century classroom, which is already over here. Recall the traditional classroom, with the teacher mostly concentrating on information transmission. And recall the 21st century classroom, more student-centric and with the use of digital tools. Now, according to you, which classroom is more useful for student learning? The traditional classroom, the 21st century classroom, or both are equally good? Please vote on this question, and coordinators, you may convey the results. We have 24 results that have come in. There is one for the traditional classroom, 13 for the 21st century classroom, and 10 for both are equally good. I believe we have for the 21st century classroom, we have 16 now, closely followed by both are equally good. So we can see that most people seem to think it's the 21st century classroom that is more useful for student learning, but there are also many of us who consider both as equally good. So let's go and try to see or analyze more of these. Please make two groups, A and B. You have 5 minutes. And those in group A should point out lists for why the traditional classroom is better. Perhaps at this stage we should change it to why you think both types are better, rather than traditional, considering that only one participant has voted for traditional. So could we have two groups, with one group in favor of both modes and one group in favor of the 21st century classroom? And coordinators, you are requested to send two main points in favor of the using the technique of both and for the one for the 21st century classroom through AVU chat. Again, one group for using both and one group for 21st century classroom. Let me read out some of the answers for the 21st century classroom. So 21st century classroom leads to full class involvement. In traditional, there is more face-to-face and personal interaction. In 21st century classroom, we have a lot of digital tools and innovative technology, and it increases efficiency. A couple here for traditional classrooms, explaining numerical problems, derivations are easier in traditional classrooms. There is more scope for active learning strategies in 21st century classrooms. Benefits of visualization in 21st century classroom. A lot of the answers are about visualizations, using visualization software in 21st century classroom. Traditional classrooms, instant feedback from body language. Classroom flow can be customized instantaneously. Teacher can assist the students in the process of generating ideas. Almost all the answers for the 21st century classroom focus on visualization to convey clarity, to help them in the learning process. Maybe I should clarify that by traditional classroom, it doesn't, by 21st century classroom, it doesn't necessarily mean that the teacher is absent. It simply means that you have put more tools in the hands of the students and you have made it aware. It doesn't mean that we exclude the teacher entirely. A good point raised by my colleague here, she says that it's possible that some of you are thinking about distance learning where the teacher could be absent in some scenarios. Again, to emphasize, 21st century classroom doesn't necessarily mean removing the teacher from the equation of teaching or learning. It simply means putting more tools into the hand of our students and teachers using more technologies to reach out to students. So let's just see some of the limitations of traditional classrooms. I hope you all agree that it's very teacher-centric. The learning is predominantly focused on the content, and the learning outcomes themselves are very assessment-focused. The thinking order skills are predominantly in the lower order, things like remembering or understanding. And the emphasis is on 9-to-3 learning in the classroom with homework as a follow-up. Now, most of the traditional classrooms would follow this format. I'm not saying all of them. And the benefits of the 21st century classroom, I know you've listed a lot of them in relation to the software that we use, especially visualizations, to help our students to understand difficult concepts. But the main focus of the 21st century classroom is that the student is at the core of the teaching learning process. The whole process is one of focusing on the learning, and it's predominantly process oriented with the embedded content. So the process of learning is equally, if not more important, than the actual content that is being delivered. And the learning outcomes themselves are both process and content focused. That means you grade the knowledge that is in evidence, but also you grade the skills, the capabilities that the students have gained during the process of learning. Here, the thinking skills that are targeted are predominantly higher order, for example, creating or evaluating. And this is truly anytime, anywhere learning. It doesn't necessarily have to happen in the classroom. The learning could happen outside the classroom too. It doesn't mean we completely remove the teacher, but we just facilitate learning through transformative technology use. So I do hope that I have clarified exactly what I mean when I say 21st century classroom. So let us see, how do we switch from a traditional classroom to a 21st century classroom? Now this essentially means that we switch to 21st century teaching and we make available to our students 21st century learning, which is through giving students digital learning tools. So the switch is basically a mindset and also the use of the tools and technologies in our classrooms. So let's look at it more in detail. Let's reflect on the 21st century learner. And for this, I would like you to recall the students in your classrooms. If they are like any of my students, they would all have mobile devices, they would all have Facebook accounts, they would all be perfectly capable of multitasking, listening to music, crossing the street, at the same time texting on WhatsApp. So this is the generation that we are dealing with. And these are the learners who like to use multiple multimedia information sources. They are fully capable of parallel processing and of multitasking. Their thought processes, the processing order is first pictures, then maybe video, sound, and then text. I don't think it's possible to get them to read first before they actually do something. Random access to interactive media is a hallmark of these 21st century learners, and they are able to both interact and network simultaneously with many people. They are comfortable in both virtual and real spaces, and for them it is essential that learning should be relevant, it should be instantly useful, and it should be fun. I do believe when I say that the majority of learners in the world fall into this category. There may be some classrooms or some societies where students haven't actually caught up with technology use, but they certainly have learned some of these aspects and they're moving forward at a rate which I believe we cannot even assess at this moment. So it's happening. The 20th century, 21st century learner is already here and is present in our classroom. So what does it mean, let us reflect, about giving digital learning tools in the hands of these students? Firstly, there are technologies that support learning specifically by 21st century students, and we should be looking at these because these support both the process and the action of learning, as well as the process and action of using technologies. And they contain both the cognitive elements as well as the methods and the tools for using these. But most important, they facilitate what 21st century learners yearn for, that is, to create, to communicate, and to collaborate. And we should be making this possible both within and outside our classroom. So digital learning tools are about empowering our students to use these tools to show how much of the learning that they have achieved. All of us are familiar with Bloom's revised taxonomy. From the lower order thinking skills to the higher order thinking skills, in some aspect we have used them, whether to write our learning outcomes or to align them with the assessments, or more importantly, to target our learning and teaching activities in class so that we are actually activating these. Just as a follow-up to what you already know, creating, evaluating, analyzing, target the more higher order thinking skills. Applying, understanding, and remembering is what we generally consider as the lower order thinking skills. And it is our task and our goal to move our students from the lower order thinking skills to the higher order thinking skills. Now let us look at Bloom's revised taxonomy in terms of the verbs that we activate in order for our students to learn the learning outcomes that we want them to. For example, let's look at creating. Normally, we would give them tasks to do with designing, constructing, planning, producing, inventing, devising, and making something. And from this, we would be able to understand if our students have reached this goal of being able to create something. On the different levels, let me just go through it rapidly, though I know that you are quite familiar with this. For evaluating, we check, we expect them to hypothesize, critique, experiment, judge, test, detect, and monitoring. For analyzing, we are looking at the capability of comparing, organizing, deconstructing, attributing, outlining, finding, structuring, and integrating. We check for application through how they have implemented something, carried out, used, or executed. For understanding, we are looking at the capability for interpreting, summarizing, inferring, paraphrasing, classifying, comparing, explaining, and exemplifying. And finally, to test for remembering, we expect them to recognize, list, describe, identify, retrieve, name, locate, and find information that we want them to do. So we are very familiar with this, and I would like you to keep Bloom's revised taxonomy in mind as we move forward with the rest of this session. Now, please recall what we reflected about the 21st century learner and about digital learning tools. Now, my question to you is, which taxonomy is more useful for us as teachers to assess student learning outcomes in the 21st century classroom? Do you think we can still continue to use Bloom's revised taxonomy? Should we aim or look for a new digital taxonomy? Or do you think both are equally good? Again, it's important to recall the 21st century learner as already being present in our classrooms, and that we are giving or hope to give them digital learning tools. So the question is, which taxonomy do you think is more appropriate for us now? Bloom's revised taxonomy, a new digital taxonomy, or do you think both are equally good? Please vote on this, and coordinators, please convey the vote. We have the answers coming in. So far, we have both are equally good at, may I see the numbers, 9, a new digital taxonomy for 6, and Bloom's revised taxonomy, 2 users. More results are coming in. Both are equally good, now at 16 users voting for it. New digital taxonomy for 7, and Bloom's revised 5. We still have the maximum number of users voting for both are equally good. Let us look at the problems with traditional taxonomy, and by this I mean Bloom's revised taxonomy. Although we have been using it for a long time now, it really doesn't account for the use of new technologies in the hands of students and for the associate processes and actions that they do when they interact through and with these tools. Also, it does not do justice to the emergence of digital children and digital natives. Remember, these are people who have seen tools from the time they are born, or who have started using these tools at a very young age. Now, the other problem with Bloom's traditional taxonomy is that it is really too focused on the cognitive domain, and it's not really useful for activities that we undertake in the classroom. Think about how you would assess, for example, collaborative work using this taxonomy. And this is one of the main reasons why we should either be looking at another taxonomy, or we should take elements of Bloom's revised taxonomy and work with it to ensure that we are able to take into account these new outcomes that we expect from our students. So let's go look at it. Let's reflect on a typical digital taxonomy that we might create, or which might exist and which I could point out to you. Actually, there is one such. It is the work of Andrew Churches. And what he has done is to map Bloom's revised taxonomy to learning outcomes that take into account the use of both digital tools and technologies. So in a sense, when we had the poll and the results of those who said that the results which showed that both taxonomies should be used, Bloom's revised and a new digital, well, we already have it. It's Andrew Church's digital taxonomy. Now, this one, through this, we are able to assess how students use digital tools to achieve recall, understanding, application, analysis, evaluation, and creativity. And it basically targets the use of digital tools by our 21st century learners. So let's go look at it more in detail. Here we have Bloom's revised digital taxonomy. So note that we still have the learning outcomes from Bloom's revised taxonomy, that is creating, evaluating, analyzing, applying, understand, and remembering. What has changed is the learning activity that we can now get our students to use to get them to achieve these learning outcomes. For example, see the ones for creating. You can get your students to do programming, filming, animating, blogging, wikiing, publishing, video casting, podcasting, modeling. Now, I do need to point out that these are just a few examples. These are mostly what my students have done or what I have knowledge of. But there really are many more that you could add to the for example, the creating level. And it's up to you to decide what falls into this taxonomy by way of learning activity using a particular digital tool. Look at the ones that you can actually get your students to use when you want them to achieve the outcome, evaluating. You can get your students to comment, write critical comments, review, post, moderate, network, refactor, or test. For analyzing, you can get your students to do mashing, surveying, linking, tagging, reverse engineering. It is easy to see, understand how students are applying what you have taught when they're, for example, running programs, loading, playing games, operating, hacking, ethical hacking, may I note, uploading, sharing, or editing. In the same way, we can assess for understanding through how our students are doing advanced searches. How are they blogging, commenting, annotating, subscribing to different feeds, for example. And to test for remembering, we can get them to do bullet pointing, highlighting, bookmarking, searching, or note taking. Now, I would like you to reflect on this for a few minutes before I change the slide. Please look at the learning activities. I'm sure you can think of many more that I have missed at each of the levels. Now, how do we use this digital taxonomy, and how do we get our students to achieve the levels that we want them to be at? The problem is mapping digital tools to learning outcomes and activities. And this will now be in the form of activity for you to do. So let's start. Look at the outcome creating. Centers, please note, you can get your students to do programming, filming, animating, blogging, writing wikis, publishing, video casting, podcasting, and modeling. At this point, could you please note down one of these learning activities for each center? Again, to repeat, programming, filming, animating, blogging, wikiing, publishing, video casting, podcasting, modeling. If you could choose one of these, we can move on to the activity. Suppose your institute made it compulsory for students to use digital learning tools. I said suppose, in your classroom. Now, for the learning active outcome, creating, please spend 2 minutes individually to think Which digital learning tool would you consider in your classroom given the content that you are teaching? And please write down your individual answer. For the learning outcome creating, which digital tool would you recommend for your student? If you would like to see the learning activities again, they are here for you. We have some answers coming in. Guwahati, 1020 Center, programming, video casting, filming and animation, modeling, programming and animating, programming and using a simulator, animating, video casting, animating. Okay, now can you think of a specific tool that you would give them? For example, which programming tool, or which tool for animation, or which site for blogging, or which site for doing the wiki? Concentrate on the tool, please, not so much on the activity. Which tool would you give them, or which tool would you recommend for your students? I see animation. Which animation tool would you recommend? Which programming IDE would you recommend? We are now going down to the specific tool. Adobe, I can see. MATLAB for modeling, AutoCAD for modeling, yes. I now see specific tools. Eclipse for programming, yes. Maya for animation, yes, you're getting it now. Okay, so now I see specific tools, Blender, MATLAB, very good. Okay, now can you please examine your neighbor's answer, and can you please discuss if the tool that you have both suggested, does it really help students to work at the highest cognitive level? And would you consider this tool for the learning outcome creating? Please share with your neighbor. Now we are looking at the level of the tools. Can you find some reasons for why you should recommend the tool? In what way does it help this learning outcome creating? Cam Studio, Maya, YouTube, yes, Flash. Please discuss how do these address the learning outcome creating. Video recording tools, could you specify exactly which tool you think your student should be using? You're now discussing at the level of the tool. We have a few answers. It demonstrates the working sequence, the animation tool. Using the 8051 simulator, they can register changes as the program executes. Yes, now you are discussing it at the level of the tool. Specific tool, and how does it allow our students to achieve the learning outcome creating? I have here programming tools. Perhaps you can specify which programming tools you're thinking about and how it actually helps. We have one from podcasting. Students can attend the class from anywhere. The CEC-71 helps in finding temperature in the rocket combustion chamber. Remember, these are tools in the hands of the students, not so much for teaching. MATLAB, simulation of vibration signals. Again, please note, this is not for you to demonstrate, for example, simulation of vibration signals, but for students to actually learn to create using MATLAB, or learn to create using a specific digital tool. So the outcome would be some product that they are creating, for example, a video, or the students create a podcast. I think I need to clarify that. Creation where there is an end product for you to grade, both as a product and the process of how the students have made the product using a tool for creating. We're not discussing a teaching tool. It would help to think what would be the end product when the student uses this tool. Is there something that is created? Tyagaraj College of Engineering, Madurai, they can actually arrive at new solutions from team effort. That is very good, through the act of creating something. Could the coordinators please give us a few answers? There are some who are already giving us in chat view. Again, specific, the tool for creating something, the product at the end of it, which you can then grade, including the process of how that product was created. A tool in the hands of the students for them to create that proves that they have achieved this learning outcome. We are now sharing. Video casting, effort to convey greater content is less. I see animating. So the end product would be an animation of what? What knowledge would they be demonstrating? 3D modeling tools I see, AutoCAD drafting tools, yes, there would be products over there. Flash for animation, yes, but how is it tied to the content? What exactly would they be producing using this animation or video software? for you to see that they have understood some content. But what is to be created? Exactly. I have something from Center 1064 that it depends on the content. And that is what I would like you to think. I would like you to tie the use of this tool to a specific content, because they have to create something tied to a content. And that is what I'm trying to look at it for in your answers. A particular concept or a specific thing that you wish them to demonstrate in terms of knowledge gained. It's much too generic to say just use a tool. Your students would have to know exactly what they are supposed to be creating and what they're supposed to demonstrate through it. Yes, fluency in some mathematical model, a realistic product made modeled in CAD software. Yes, now we're getting to the specifics. Programming for a TPS, small module can be solved by individual, solve problem can be compared with neighbor and teacher. That's an interesting use. I still have some very generic answers, interesting, interactive. I believe we should really tie it to the content, so it's clear to the students what exactly we want them to do with the tool and how we expect to grade both the product and the process of working with the tool. Yes, create videos and PowerPoints. Okay, let's move on. I believe we have done our 10 minutes with this activity. So let me give you some examples that I had for creating. For programming, you could get students, for example, to use Scratch, Alice, Visual Studio, Lego Mindstorm. For filming and animating, they could create a movie based on the content they have learned, Animoto, Pencil. For blogging and wikis, they could use Blogger, Moodle wikis, Wikispaces. For publishing, they could use Word, OpenOffice Writer, Mixbook, Portfolio Box, which actually allows a variety of media to be used to demonstrate your learning. Video casting and podcasting, some of the tools are VoiceThread, Skype, Illuminate. And for modeling, you can have SketchUp, you can have Blender, and as I could see, of course, you have many more tools that you think that your students can use. So now that we understand that there is a process that is involved with using the tool, please keep in mind that any tool you suggest, try to tie it to specific content. So let's move on to the next outcome. Here we are looking at evaluating. You need to develop in your students the skill of evaluating. And for that, we want them to comment critically. We want them to review, say, papers. We want them to post. We want them to moderate other people's opinions. We expect them to network, both within class, with experts worldwide. We expect them to refactor code, and of course, we expect them to test programs. So all these, in some ways, allow our students to evaluate, and it is then for us to figure out if they have achieved this evaluation standard. So again, we do this exercise. Now that you have understood, please choose any one level, commenting, reviewing, posting, please choose any one learning activity. For that, try to think of a specific tool and tie it to some specific content instead of just making a generic statement. Again, commenting, as in critical, reviewing, posting, moderating, networking, refactoring, and testing. And the activity? For this learning outcome, evaluating, when you have chosen one of the learning activities, try to identify at least one digital tool and then share it. I will move the slide back to the evaluating so you can see the learning. You can see the learning activity. Yes, evaluating. How would you expect your students to comment, review, post, moderate, network, refactor, and test so that you know that they are evaluating some written text, or they're evaluating a tool, or they're evaluating other people's posts, or rather the need to be able to evaluate something. I see wikis for networking. Which tool would you use? I see testing. Which testing tools are you thinking about? Aditya Institute of Technology and Management. Which testing tools are you thinking about? We have Sri Vishnu Engineering College for Women, Andhra Pradesh. The audio is breaking. I see testing. What kind of tools would you put in the hands of your students? Ah, now I see. Packet tracer for testing network settings, good. Using Moodle, not too clear about what exactly you intend to do with Moodle. Again, I see Moodle. Moodle to evaluate a design proposal, that is specific. Google Docs for discussion, yes. But are they evaluating a piece of content? So one another's posts and discussions, discussion about that. Testing of antennas, Stack Exchange. Blogs for commenting, yes. Do you know of any particular blogging tool that you would like them to use? Proteus for simulating and testing for circuits. That is very specific. A lot of specific content tied to tools now, and specific names of tools coming up now. PageMaker for reviewing, yes. Testing Windrunner. Load runners can be used as tools to help students test, yes. Skype for commenting and reviewing, yes. I'm not sure Skype keeps the document. You'd probably have to use Google Docs and then talk about it. Rational Rows, testing tools. Reviewing plagiarism, Wiper, excellent tool to put in the hands of students. WhatsApp for commenting, that's a new one. Blogger tools, Blogger for commenting. Google Drive to share and receive comments of the students, yes. Facebook, yes, for gathering comments and reviewing them and critically talking about them. Again, Facebook for commenting. Very popular choice among students anyway. Any kind of social networking tools, better to be very specific. Skype discussions, yes. Okay, so you get the gist of it. We are looking at what tools we can put in the hands of students so we get them to evaluate critically. It could be evaluate a program, a piece of content, or evaluate even the peer work. So peer review tools, evaluation tools for peer review. So these are some of the things that we can use. Moving on, here are some examples that I had. And I think some of them I could already see. So for commenting and posting, students can use Blogspot, Facebook, even Moodle Forum. For reviewing, you can use Microsoft Word, Review Board, Collaborator, very good for collaborative work. Moderating, Moodle Forum, students can take turns. Networking, maintaining email lists, LinkedIn, Facebook. For refactoring, Eclipse, Shark Develop, Code Rush Express. For testing, Wireshark, Snort, Metalspoit. Most of these are what I'm familiar with or what I have seen students using. But as I can see from the chat view, a lot of you also have your own favorite tools, Twitter, yes? So the point is that sometimes it is better to allow our students to choose their tools. And that way there are two benefits. One, we get to learn about a tool we never heard of. And two, we actually get to see the variety of tools that we can then recommend for the next batch of our students. So there's something about allowing tools, the choice of tools to the students. As long as they have attained our goal, which is they have developed the skill of evaluating either a content or a program or the discussions of the points raised by other people, so we have achieved our purpose. So I believe really that the tool is not as important. It's more important that the tool is in the hands of the students, that they're comfortable using it, and that they are able to demonstrate the learning that has occurred, mostly in groups. Moving on to analyzing, you can get your students to do mashing, surveying, linking, tagging, reverse engineering. If you can think of any other tools for any other activities for analyzing, please go ahead. Again, we follow the format. We choose one of the levels. We look for specific tools, and we tie it to content within our classes. I have two questions here I will answer. Can you please elaborate the term refactoring? I guess from someone coming from a programming background, I'm looking at refactoring code to optimize it. In that context, refactoring was used. And there is another query about the digital taxonomy. I'll go back to it again. People have now started choosing. They're surveying. Rational Rows for reverse engineering, yes. We are moving on to choosing tools for analyzing and tying it to specific content. Online feedback for surveying. Perhaps you could name a survey tool that you think you can recommend to your students. Again, we are looking at tools for analyzing. Google Forms, yes. Favorite tool for my students to gather feedback. Raptor for reverse engineering. SurveyMonkey, yes, I've used that. Google Form clearly is a favorite here. Google Forms, SurveyMonkeys for surveying. Surveying social networking sites. Perhaps you could be a little more specific. Excel for different values and outputs. Yes, to analyze, an excellent analysis tool actually. Microsoft Word for tagging, yes. Polls, yes, with clickers, yes. Tagging in Facebook, yes. Statistical tools for data analysis, perhaps a little more specific. What kind of what can you come up with? A lot of survey tools are being mentioned here. LinkedIn for linking with others, yes. Tools like Excel and SPSS for analyzing, of course, especially data from surveys. Okay, so let's look at some of the examples that I have here. NetBeans, yes. Okay, so here are some of the examples that I came up with. For mashing, get students to incorporate data from both Google Maps and Google Earth. Surveying, of course, clearly the favorite here was Google Forms, followed by SurveyMonkey. You can get students to link data from databases, MySQL, Access, Base, or even from spreadsheets, Excel, Calc, and concept mapping software. For tagging, they can learn how to use Evernotes or tables. For reverse engineering, I had some typically tied with Java and C#, Boomerang, JAD, Oli Debug. Google search for trends, very good, that's a good one. Answers still coming in, Google search for trends, linking, TeamViewer, Excel for analyzing, yes. So as you can see, there are a number of tools that I have not mentioned that you have come up with. And what is nice to see is that now you are specifically tying it to content. So these are some of the recommendations that you can give to your students when you want to test them for analyzing, when you want to find out if they have actually learned how to analyze. And it could be any form of data that you want them to analyze. Okay, we are moving on to the next learning outcome, that is applying. You know when students have applied what they have learned, when they are able to run, load, play, operate, hack, upload, share, and edit. The activity for you is to find a specific tool and tie it to some content so that we know what exactly you're going to recommend to the student. For example, it could be, please use this tool to demonstrate your understanding of some content. We have sharing, Facebook, WhatsApp, playing, not very clear here what you mean by playing. Uploading FTP, yes. Sharing Moodle, Dropbox, Google Drive, yes. Uploading to YouTube, yes. Student created videos. Windrunner for running, can you actually run it? Yes. Editing in Microsoft Office, answers coming in very fast now. Can you edit documents? Certainly a skill to learn. Again, YouTube, Dropbox, VLC for playing, Google Drive for loading, MediaFire, RapidShare, SlideShare for uploading content for slides, YouTube on specific matters that you want them to make a video about, hacking using Kali Linux, sharing your Google Drive, sharing on social media, Dropbox, Flickr. I saw a student on an environmental study who had shared their photographs of marine erosion on Flickr. Gmail hacker for hacking, ethically I'm sure. YouTube for content uploading, yes, that could be a good way to even summarize the content. Editing in Google Doc. Names of tools coming in very fast, some still not tied to content. How would they be using this tool? For what would they be using it? What exactly do you expect them to achieve? Many names of tools still, Movie Maker, Google Docs, Do Ink for editing, I have not heard of that. So if you expect them to actually be able to apply what you have learned, then it looks like we do have a lot of tools and you would have to be specific of what exactly they're supposed to do. Adobe Photoshop for editing, yes. Sharing on Google Groups. Podomatic for playing. YouTube clearly seems to be a favorite here. Instagram, very nice. A lot of my students now share on Instagram, especially when they're doing projects outside the classroom. Here are some of the ones that I have as examples. For running, loading, operating, it could be any program that you want them to be able to install on any operating system, for example. It's a really important skill that they should be able to achieve. And playing, whether they are able to actually download, install, and run visualizations, simulations, or even things like Second Life. Hacking tools for students, Armitage, Wi-Fi, social engineering toolkit. Many, many tools for uploading and sharing content. Hopefully this is curated content, and within the group there are students who are acting as moderators and there are students who are actually looking at what the teacher wants before they simply upload all kinds of resources. So we're looking at Google Drive, Dropbox, SugarSync. I didn't see SugarSync anywhere. And then for editing. Editing in the sense that they're curating the content or making content available for sharing. In Microsoft Word, Photoshop, Pixar, LibreOffice, Writer. I see Google Docs, web page editing, editing through Word and Photoshop. Yes, I have just put up the list that I thought would be useful. FileZilla for uploading, Skype for sharing, Kingsoft Office, no, I'm not aware of that. I think it is useful for us to suggest freely available open source tools for our students so that they are not tied down to proprietary vendors. And also it is important for us to keep what students have presented as resources for the next semester, for the next batch of students. Very often I use example samples from previous projects to show what the students have done. And there is also this process of the teacher himself or herself learning from the student's project. I'm always amazed at the kind of tools they can unearth, and I'm always amazed at the kind of content that they are able to find. So in a sense, what we are allowing them to do is not just learn from us, but learn from what is available and to learn from one another. So I think putting digital tools in the hands of our students certainly has multiple benefits. We are looking at understanding, as in able to use advanced searches, able to blog to show your understanding of some particular topic, able to comment, annotate, or even to subscribe to sites which offer information in a compact form. Understanding as a learning outcome, activities, advanced searches, blogging, commenting, annotating, subscribing. What we are looking for is a specific tool, and what we are looking for is a content that our student can actually use to do this. Google and Yahoo for searching. I do believe what we should look at is the authenticity of the information that they're bringing back to us. Wikipedia, a great way to teach our students what to believe and not what not to believe in. Google searches, especially using Boolean operators. Google search, clearly the winner. Bing. Wikipedia for searching content. YouTube for subscribing. Yes, there are a lot of educational videos. Google Scholar, yes. Twitter for information sharing, yes, concise, where you have to learn to condense. Quora for subscribing. Blogging in WordPress, yes. Again, Facebook, but perhaps you could tie it to exactly how they would be using it. Index journals, yes. Twitter, Gmail, subscribing to many different feeds, and Facebook for commenting. Thank you for clarifying. Again, Facebook for commenting. Blogspot for blogging. Again, commenting through Facebook. It's very interesting to see when students set up their own Facebook groups and they take turns as a moderator and how they arrive at consensus. I think the process of collaboration is visible for the teacher to see, and it is easy to grade those who are actually doing the work. Encyclopedias for searching, hopefully online. Let us look at some of the examples that I have for you. I think you have given me a lot more. LaTeX and Microsoft Word for annotating. Okay, so this is what I have for you. Advanced searches, I had Google, that is Boolean searches. Blogging using Blogger, WordPress, Tumblr. I have the names of the tools here. Commenting in Twitter, Microsoft Word, on different notice boards. Forums, in threaded discussions. Annotating PDF files, annotating reference management systems like Zotero and Mendeley, Ink2Go, subscribing to RSS feeds, news aggregators for blog lines, Indest I have here, journals. Excellent, subscribing to ACM and IEEE, very good. Bounce app for annotating. So we have a lull in the Science Direct. So that would mostly come under subscribing to different digital libraries, I guess. So let us move on. We are now at the lower level outcome, remembering. We expect our students to be able to recall through, for example, bullet pointing, highlighting, bookmarking, searching, and note taking. What kind of tools would we use, and how would they, for example, demonstrate that they are able to recall information? What tool would you use for bookmarking? Bullet pointing using PowerPoint, everyone's favorite, yes. Microsoft and PowerPoint are overwhelmingly the winners. Yahoo and Google for bookmarking, yes. You can carry your bookmarks with you from device to device. PDF reader for highlighting, I do that a lot. Ocular for highlighting, not aware of that. Bookmarking using any web browser, yes. Now almost all of them come with bookmarks you can migrate from place to place. Adobe Reader for highlighting, clearly the winner. Opera Mini for saving pages. NPTEL videos. Bookmarking in any web browser, yes. Notepad for note taking. Ah, I see my favorite, Digo for bookmarking. Sticky notes. I personally prefer Evernote. Thank you for that. InNote, not aware of that. Well, I would really have to go through all these and make a list and again circulate it for you because there are a lot of things which I don't know. Tablets for note taking, yes. The devices are getting smaller and smaller now. Okay, so most people seem to think that highlighting is good with PDF files and PowerPoints are great for bullet points. I do hope you have read that paper, Deaths to Bullet Points in PowerPoint. A very interesting paper of why you should not have bullet points. Evernote, yes. We have a problem here with the AView application. Note taking for mobiles, yes. Let's look at some of the examples that I had for you. For bullet pointing, I had PowerPoint, mind mapping, flashcards, making glossary. I've used the glossary successfully with students so that they are able to pull out those aspects of the content which they think are important and which allow me to see how they are viewing the content. For highlighting, any word processor or PDF document, bookmarking, Digo, Delicious, Site You Like. For searching, of course, search engines are better, like Dogpile and WebCrawler. Note taking, clearly Evernote is my favorite, but you can also use others like Google Keep, Quip, OneNote, SpringPad, Simple Note. Please encourage your students to take notes electronically so that they can view it on different devices, and most important, they can present it to you as firstly paying attention in class, and secondly for you to understand exactly how they view the content that you are delivering. Or you can give them an assigned piece of reading and they can summarize in the form of bullet points. So note taking is really useful for this. There's Microsoft Word Tracker for notes, very good. And Note One, or is it OneNote? OneNote. Thank you. So I believe I have learnt more about tools here from you than you have from me. There really are an enormous number of note-taking tools that you have listed here. And as I promised, I will go through it and make a file to circulate. I have a question for you. Now that we have understood that we can use Bloom's revised taxonomy and we can actually use it in the format of a digital taxonomy by adding the tools and by looking at how our students can use the tools to activate the particular learning outcome, do you think that we should add collaboration as a learning outcome to this digital taxonomy? You will recall the levels of the Bloom's revised taxonomy. You will recall that we have added tools to activate those learning outcomes. My question to you is, should we have another level, collaboration? The answers for you to choose are, yes, we should. No, we should not. And the third one is, collaboration should be an integral part of all the learning outcomes, irrespective of which tool they are using. Please vote on the question, and coordinators, you may convey the results. We are talking about adding collaboration as another level of a learning outcome in view of the fact that we expect our students to collaboratively use tools in the 21st century classroom. Should collaboration be a learning outcome that is specifically assessed? Yes, no. Or should it be part of every other learning outcome? We have the yes, the no, and it should be part. And we have 15 users telling us that collaboration should be an integral part of all outcomes. Yes, we should. And there are none for no. Or is there one? Thirteen users believe we should actually have collaboration as a specific learning outcome and we should grade, assess our students for it. And 18 believe it should really be part of the other learning outcomes. So collaboration is part of, for example, creating or analyzing or evaluating. One more time, we look at the results. And we have now 21 users who believe that collaboration should be an integral part of all learning outcomes and 14 who believe, yes, we should actually have a separate level for it. Collaboration is not really a 21st century skill that we expect our students to learn. It is a 21st century essential. Just look around you at how much information we are sharing and why information sharing is so good for us. think about it, for example, in terms of disasters. The information that we share is actually saving lives. And for students, sharing information or sharing ideas about how to address certain points in their assessments is only one way for them to increase their knowledge, but also another way for them to learn the skills of collaboration. So really, I don't see the need for why we should have collaboration as a separate learning skill. It should be essential within all the learning outcomes that we are aiming at within Bloom's revised taxonomy. Learning, I'm sure we all agree, is enhanced by collaborating. And collaboration can be used throughout the learning process, through all the learning outcomes that we have been looking at and all the tools that we have been looking at. And in fact, there are specific collaborative tools that help the process of collaboration. And this is explicitly what we should be asking our students to use so that they, most importantly, they learn from each other and they're able to share the outcomes of these learnings with each other, not just with the teacher. So here are some collaborative tools that you might like to reflect on. Sharing student presentations through Prezi, Glockster, YouTube. Blogging so that the entire class is able to see through EduBlogs, Class Blogmeister. Collaborating on documents and then sharing it with other groups through Google, Zoho, or OpenOffice. Sharing through social networking, Ning, or even Facebook groups. And sharing through learning management systems. Moodle, as you will recall, has a number of collaborative tools, and we should be using them to the fullest, especially the wikis, which allow students to collaborate on documents and to present reports which are really the outcome of consensus within the group. And it is this process of consensus that we should track. How are students arriving at consensus? What is the process by which they're deciding? This information should go into the collaborative document, or this one should be withheld. And that is what we should be tracking, the learning, both during the process of learning and as the end product that they submit to us. And of course, for communicating, increasingly, in the beginning, I used to find students messaging each other. Then I found that they would use Facebook. Now it's mostly either Skype or Google Hangout, where they can actually go look at the document and talk to each other. So given the choice, students will choose those tools which they are, one, comfortable with, and two, which they find works very well within the group. So it might be interesting for you to actually not suggest any collaborative tools, but get the students to use their own collaborative tools, and in the process of presenting their projects, to also, for example, to give reasons why they choose a collaborative tool, and what were the problems with it, and what did they learn from it. So in this sense, we grade everything. We grade the finished product, we grade the process of learning, and we grade the collaborative elements within that learning. So the final part of this presentation, how do we get students to use digital tools for assignments? The easiest way, of course, is to make it compulsory, to tell them that they cannot hand in written assignments unless it is an electronic document. But also there are some things that you might like to keep in mind. The first and most important is that you need to tie the use of the tool to some specific learning content and to a learning outcome. So it never should be the use of the tool just for the sake of using the tool. It should be the tool for the purpose of dealing with some knowledge component, and the outcome should be one of the levels on Bloom's hierarchy, and at the same time you should be aware that the students should be made aware of these things. It is your, I guess, your, along with the in the rubric or along with the assignment details, you should be pointing this out to students. Then I have found it necessary to give students an opportunity to first gain exposure to the tool before the assignment. So there could be a session in class or outside where they could get together and actually use the tool before they actually start the assignment. Now, I don't suggest that every one of us should become experts in using the tools. Many of the tools that my students use, I'm not even aware until they tell me about it. And it has been an interesting experience for me to learn about these tools and to try and use these tools along with them. And we all have to agree that there is a huge learning curve in using any new tool. So we do need to give our students a time gap when they can play around with some of the tools, and then they can decide which one, and of course they should be informing you about it. Another thing that I have found helpful is, if I am going to recommend a tool, or if I make it mandatory for them to use a tool, then I make sure that I'm providing links to help manuals and tutorials on using the tools. we cannot expect all our students to have the same level of capability or competences that some students may have. So especially if you are making it compulsory, then you would also need to provide some tutorials and links to help manuals. And finally, what I have found really useful when asking students to use tools to demonstrate their learning is to provide some mechanism for them to get feedback, both from their peers, from any teaching assistants, and of course from the lecturer. So it's really important that you give feedback about how they dealt with the content, the knowledge content, how they dealt with the tool, and of course how they dealt with the process of working together. So these three things could form the main components for any rubric that you would have for an assignment for which you expect your students to use digital tools. As a final summary, what we have done today is that we have looked at digital tools that are useful for students to use, not just in class, but also out of class. And specifically, we have looked at tools for students to create, to communicate, and to collaborate. And in this exercise, we have used Bloom's revised digital taxonomy, which builds on the very popular and well-known Bloom's revised taxonomy, but looks at it from the aspect of which digital tools we can use for which learning outcome. And we have talked about mapping these outcomes to specific knowledge content and to how the students have used these tools. So I do hope you have found this session interesting, and I also hope that you are now inspired to put tools in the hands of your students and allow them to get back to you not only about what they have learned, but how they have dealt with the tool, and most important, how they have learned to work together with these tools.